presentation of the Rio Grande Oil Company.
Lieutenant Police calling all cars, attention all cars. Calling all Los Angeles County Sheriff's cars, broadcast 50, regarding a murder on Riverside Drive. All cars be on the lookout for a Buick Coupe, page 642, 8S Sugar 642, 8 Sugar 642. The suspect is believed to have escaped in this car. That's all. Rose and Chris.
Patrol car 42.
That's right.
And you must be Officer Whalen.
Well, that's the second time.
I'm Officer Harris. The inspector assigned me to ride with you while your partner's on the sick list.
Okay, hop in. Let's get going. Ever done any radio patrol work before?
No, this is my first offense. And I've listened to a description of your work on the Calling All Cars radio program. Say, tell me, do these police cars really use Rio Grande crack gasoline?
Sure they do. So the police cars in other cities. Crack gasoline does everything they say it does. Cities specify for all police cars, ambulances, and fire engines.
Yeah, but do you think gasoline really makes much difference in the police car?
Huh? I'll show you. Now here, we're just crawling along at 5 miles an hour, notice?
Calling car 42, car 42, a burglary of 836 Huron Street, 836 Huron Street. Go get them, boys.
Here we go. Miles an hour. Boy, I'll show you what police car performance means. We'll use every bit of power we can get out of that Rio Grande crack gasoline.
Tonight, Chief James E. Davis of the Los Angeles Police Department has brought a guest with him, whom he will introduce. Chief Davis.
Good evening, friends. It is a great source of satisfaction to me to observe how more and more the law enforcement agencies of the nation work closer and closer together. Whenever a major crime occurs these days, all facilities of municipal, county, state, and federal police are merged into a cooperative and a crime army, with the result that fewer and fewer crimes remain unsolved. Tonight's story did not come under my official jurisdiction. It was solved under the direction of my guest and good friend, Gene Biscalouz, Sheriff of Los Angeles County. And I have asked Gene to be my guest in the studio tonight and to say a few words to you. Ladies and gentlemen, Gene Biscalouz, Sheriff of Los Angeles County.
Thanks, Jim. Good evening, friends of the Pacific Coast. The Los Angeles Police Department and the Sheriff's Office have worked many cases together, for had not the desire to catch the criminal subordinated any personal desire to grab the glory, there would not have been such a high percentage of solved crimes to which both departments can point with pride. Tonight's dramatization of Calling All Cars is a case in point, where through the splendid cooperation of Chief of Police Elmer Adams of Burbank and Captain William J. Bright of the Sheriff's Homicide Detail, the criminal was in custody within 24 hours after the crime was discovered. Peace officers today are working towards closer and closer cooperation, which eventually will make the criminal's career so hazardous that crime will be minimized to a great extent. There will always be crime, particularly in metropolitan areas, and the peace officer or any department cannot expect to do the job alone, and is our honest and unceasing effort to do our best and to give better service working together. Tonight's story begins with Six Shots at Midnight. On with the show.
Mr. Lewis, wake up! Wake up! Mrs. O'Wire, I don't know. It sounded like a gun being fired. Oh, and someone's dying.
What's the trouble, Mrs. Spencer?
Why, didn't you hear it?
Well, quiet. I was sleeping. I didn't hear nothing till you knocked on my door.
Well, there was shots and a scream. And then Miss Smith and I heard groans.
We'd better go through the apartments and find out if everyone's all right.
That's right. Lewis, go to the court downstairs, and I'll check this floor.
Yes, ma'am, right away.
Oh, come along, Miss Smith. We'll see if Mrs. Madison's all right. Chances are she's alone tonight. And, well, let's see in here. Mrs. Madison, are you there? Are you all right? If you're all right, answer me.
I'm all right, Mrs. Spencer.
Did you hear those shots? And that terrible groan, Mrs. Madison?
Yes, they woke me up.
Oh, it's terrible. I'm just sure that someone's been murdered.
Oh, I think you're unduly upset. The shots probably came from the studio down the street. They're making a picture there tonight.
Yes, but those horrible groans and that shriek.
You're forgetting the peacocks in the backyard. Their shriek sounds very human.
Oh, I'm just sure somebody's been murdered.
Well, Mrs. Spencer, I've been all around the court downstairs, and everyone's all right.
And Mrs. Madison thinks the noise came from the picture studio.
Well, now, it might have a side.
There, listen to that. And there go the peacocks. Now, they sound very much like a human being.
And, there's your mother, Mrs. Spencer.
Oh, I'm just sure I heard human groans.
Just goes to show what the imagination will do for you.
Yes, Mrs. Spencer. I'm sure you imagined you heard human groans.
Well, maybe.
You better go back to bed, Mrs. Spencer. I know I need my sleep. Good night, all.
Just the same. They sounded like human groans.
Take this apartment.
Yeah, I'm sure you'll like it here.
I know I shall. It's so close to the studio. Lucky I ran into Miss Madison over the studio restaurant the other day. I'd never known about your playing.
Indeed, it is.
I wonder if Mrs. Madison is in. I'd like to tell her I'm going to be a new neighbor.
Well, I haven't seen her since last night. She left a note on the door this morning, not to be disturbed. But certainly she's up by now. Now, come this way. She's just down the hall. Hmm. Her note's still there. Well, if she isn't awake, she ought to be.
That's right. She's no right to be sleeping in the middle of a nice Sunday afternoon like this.
Mrs. Madison. Oh, Mrs. Madison.
Maybe something happened to her.
She might have left the gas heater on too high and been overcome.
Have you passed the gas? Yes. Would you better open the door then?
Yes, sir. Yes, I think I have. Mrs. Madison.
Ooh, Mrs. Madison.
Not here.
Well, the bed's still down. Maybe she's sitting in the shower.
I'll look.
No, she's not in the bathroom.
But look!
What's the matter?
Somebody's under the bed.
Why?
That's Mr. Madison. Maybe he's drunk or sick. Blood!
Oh! It's Mrs. Spencer phones the Burbank police, and they enlist the aid of Captain Bright of the Sheriff's Homicide Detail. As quickly as high-powered police cars can carry them, Chief Elmer Adams of Burbank, accompanied by deputy sheriffs, arrive at the scene of the crime. While the police photographer photographs the victim from every angle, Captain Bright and Chief Adams attempt to reconstruct the crime.
Well, apparently he was shot in the back while he was lying in bed.
Yes, the blood in the bed sheets was seen to indicate that.
He fell off the bed in his death throes and was shot again through the right arm and the eye as he lay on the floor.
Yes, and those bullet holes in the plaster there indicate the murderer missed his mark twice. Must have been blind with anger to miss it this way.
Yeah. Oh, hello, Killian. What did you find?
Well, the victim's name is Eric Madison. He and his wife moved in here about a month ago.
Where is his wife?
She hasn't been seen since early this morning. The manager's husband saw her go out about 8 o'clock.
When was the victim last seen alive?
Last night.
Who saw him?
Lewis, the custodian.
Is he here?
No, he's right outside in the hall.
I'll talk to him.
You, Mr. Lewis?
Yes, sir?
When did you see Eric Madison alive?
Oh, last night at a few minutes before 10, he passed through the lobby on the way to his apartment.
Did he speak to you?
Yes, he said, good evening, Ed.
Where was Mrs. Madison at that time?
Sitting right there in the lobby, within a few foot of me.
Didn't Mr. Madison speak to her?
Nope. He just passed by like he hadn't seen her.
Didn't that strike you as peculiar?
Well, I noticed it all right, but in this business, we mind our own business.
Wouldn't you think that the incident showed that the couple's relationship was, well, somewhat strained, to say the least?
I bet. Matter of fact, Mrs. Madison told me a week ago she had a lot of trouble.
What kind of trouble?
I don't know.
Now, please don't hold anything back on us, Mr. Lewis. We're trying to solve a murder.
Yeah, but it ain't none of my business.
As a citizen, you're expected to help peace officers in a case like this. Now, did she tell you why she had that trouble?
Yes. She said she suspected her husband of being interested in another woman.
Did she say why she had such suspicion?
Yep. Said she checked the mileage on their car and knew that her husband must be visiting some woman in Los Angeles.
What kind of a car did they own?
Buick coupe.
You know the license number?
Oughta. Seen the car enough time. Let's see. It's AS462.
AS462. Any idea where Mrs. Madison may be now?
How should I know?
Well, where might she go if she really did commit this crime?
I don't know. But she used to run a hotel down in Palm Springs, and she told me that she's gone deer hunting up to Jack Riley's ranch in Kern County lots of times.
Is that the big ranch up near the Fraser Mountain National Park?
Yeah, that's the place, all right.
Where else might she have gone?
Well, there's her sister up in Montana.
Is that the same one whose address we found the death floor?
Well, I suppose so.
What makes you think she'd go there?
Well, just last night when we was sitting there in the lobby before Mr. Madison, he come in. She showed me a letter, and she said it was to her sister in Montana, and that she was to have everything Mrs. Madison had.
Seems to me that's a pretty significant statement. What did you say to that?
Nothing. It's not none of my business.
Returning to headquarters, Captain Bright and Deputy Sheriff Killian sit down to discuss their findings and plan their strategy.
Well, from what I can get out of that fellow Lewis, it looks as though there might be a jealousy motive.
Right.
Now, we might as well begin by eliminating the possible places to which you might escape. Got a description?
Yes, in full.
Good. Now, trace the route you might possibly take between here and Dillon, Montana, and send the description to every town along the way. Also, get it out on the state teletype. Sign Sheriff Fitzgerald's name to it.
Yes, sir.
Now, Lewis said she used to run a hotel in Palm Springs, and that she also had gone deer hunting at Jack Riley's ranch in Antelope Valley.
Well, if she'd be escaping to either of those places, she'd undoubtedly pick on Jack Riley's place. You've got a lot more chances hiding up there in the woods than you have down in the desert of Palm Springs.
Right. So let's work on the Jack Riley lead first. Now, tomorrow morning, you'd better get Chief Adams from Burbank and Deputy Sheriff Rowe and drive up there.
Yes, sir.
Early the next morning, the three officers set out north on the ridge route. At a state highway checking station, they discovered that the wanted car with the identifying license number had passed through the station the day before and had turned off toward Fraser Mountain Park. Elated, the officers hurry as fast as the steep mountain grades will permit to the ranch of Jack Riley. They are met at the door of the cabin by Riley himself.
What do you want?
Officers of the law.
Are you Jack Riley?
Yes, I'm Riley.
We've come for Nellie.
Nellie who?
Nellie Madison. She's here, isn't she?
I haven't seen Nellie Madison since last fall.
Yeah? Those tire marks in the driveway look fresh to me. Mind taking a look in the garage, Chief?
Okay. You can't go snooping around my place without a search warrant.
Now, get this straight, Mr. Riley. We're here investigating a murder. If you interfere, we'll gladly lock you up.
Now, listen, I know my rights.
If you take a bit of advice, you'll shut up.
The Buick's here, all right.
Fine. Now, Mr. Riley, you know what it means to be harboring a fugitive? Why did you say she wasn't here?
Well, she did come in yesterday, but I don't know where she is now.
Marty.
Come on, Bullard.
Now, look through this bedroom. You boys take the other room.
My request. I will not talk until I have consulted an attorney.
9th, 1934, Nellie Madison is arraigned in Burbank Police Court on a charge of first-degree murder. She pleads not guilty, and the trial is set for June 6th. Mrs. Madison refuses to make a statement. Her attorneys promise a perfect defense. Meanwhile, Deputy Sheriff search Riley's ranch and the murder apartment for the death-dealing weapon. Hours are spent plodding in the pine needles around the Riley place, but no trace of the gun is discovered. Mrs. Madison's refusal to make a statement further baffles the prosecution. As the date of the trial approaches, the police are forced to admit a double handicap. They are not in possession of the murder weapon, and they have not been able to establish a motive. The trial opens on June 6th, with Deputy District Attorneys George Stallman and Paul Palmer handling the prosecution. A jury of 8 men and 4 women is impaneled, and the routine testimony of the various witnesses is heard. The manager of the apartment house tells of discovering the body. Captain Bright and Chief Adams of Burbank testify. Spencer B. Moxley, Los Angeles Police Department ballistics expert, testifies that 2 of the death shots were fired from a range of less than 6 inches. The salesman who told Mrs. Madison the 2 guns are heard. Hot spring days pass as the tension of the courtroom grows, as the trial demands greater and greater space in the newspapers. A sensation is created when the prosecution introduces the murder bed with its blood-stained sheets as evidence. Throughout the horrible ordeal, Mrs. Madison never once loses her collected calm. Never once is anything but a lady. Then a week after the trial began, Mrs. Madison's attorneys begin their perfect defense.
Your Honor, I would like to call another witness.
You may.
Mr. Arthur, please. Promise to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth to help you, God?
I do.
Your name, please.
Ralph T. Arthur.
You were acquainted with Eric B. Madison?
Yes.
How long?
Oh, about a year.
Mr. Arthur, I have here a photograph of the body of the victim in this case as it lay on a slab in the county morgue. Is this Eric Madison?
No. That is not the Eric Madison I knew.
Order. Order in the court.
Now, Mr. Arthur, here is a picture identified as a photograph, a photographer's portrait of Eric Madison. Do you recognize it?
Why, yes, that is Eric.
Will you tell the court, please, the difference between these two pictures?
Well, this corpse here has a scar on his forehead and a mole on either side of his nose, and the picture of Eric hasn't.
Did Eric Madison have a scar on his forehead or moles on either side of his nose?
No, not that I can remember.
Your Honor, my client is accused of murdering her husband, but I will establish beyond a shadow of a doubt that she could not be guilty of this crime, for the victim is not her husband.
Identify this picture taken in the morgue. Is this the likeness of your husband?
No. I do not believe that that is a picture of my husband.
Do you recognize the man in this picture?
No, I do not.
Now, is this the studio portrait a picture of your husband?
Yes.
Are you sure that your husband didn't have a scar on his forehead and a couple of moles near his nose?
I'm certain of it. He had a little red mark on the bridge of his nose made from his glasses. But I don't remember any moles or scars.
Mrs. Madison, did you kill your husband, Eric Madison?
I did not kill him or anyone else ever.
Did you have any reason to kill him?
No.
The prosecution procures the original negative of the disputed Madison portrait from the photographer in Portland and quickly blasts the defense contention that the victim is not Madison by showing how the original negative was retouched to remove the scars and moles before the final prints were made. By June 21st, Deputy District Attorney Solomon begins his summary to the jury.
The manner and means of this crime were so abominable that the state demands and expects a verdict of murder in the first degree without recommendation. The contention of the defense that the victim is not Eric Madison is patently a fantastic hoax, which I know you intelligent ladies and gentlemen of the jury have already dismissed from your minds. If we have not proved beyond a shadow of a doubt that the murdered man is Madison, then you are entitled to retire to the jury room and find Nellie Madison not guilty. But we have proved that the victim of this atrocious crime was Eric Madison. The evidence here is that Nellie Madison has refused to talk. She demanded to see an attorney. She was smart and cunning, a woman with a wicked heart. She stands condemned on her own silence. I charge you, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, to bring back a verdict of guilty with no recommendation.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, did you ever lose suddenly and horribly someone you held most dear? Have you ever been so stunned by personal misfortune that you were cold and indifferent to all that transpired about you? If you have, then you will know what happened to Nellie Madison throughout this trial. There can be no murder without a motive. And what possible motive could this woman have? The Madisons were a loving couple. The prosecution has not only asked you to hang a woman, but by all we've shown during this trial, to hang an innocent woman. Don't do it. Don't have this thing on your souls and consciences the rest of your lives. Don't send this woman to the gallows on the tenuous strings of circumstantial evidence. Remember the command of the Almighty Father. Thou shalt not kill.
But the sentimental appeal of the defense could not sway the jury. And on June 21st, they returned a verdict of guilty of first-degree murder with no recommendation. Such a verdict amounting to mandatory death sentence. Nellie Madison has appealed her case. She is now in the women's prison at Tehachapi, awaiting that appeal.
Thank you, Sheriff DeSluz.
How did you like your first ride in the police car?
Oh, I feel kind of worn out. Oh, but what punishments you fellows give a car. I see now what Rio Grande means when they advertise police car performance with cracked gasoline.
No ordinary gasoline will do for police work. They've got to have all the power there is in the engine. Cracked gasoline's the best gasoline our city chemists could find. It has tetraethyl, too. I buy the same gasoline for my own car from that Rio Grande service station right over there. Better use it yourself.
Thanks, Waylon. I'm sold. From now on, I'll use Rio Grande cracked gasoline, too.
Los Angeles Police calling all cars. Attention all cars. Attention all Los Angeles County Sheriff's cars. Cancellation broadcast 50 regarding a murder. Suspect in this case is now in custody. That's all. Rose and Cook.
Calling all cars is written and produced by William N. Ropeson.